as we pray before you now. Jesus, we also ask this for all those not attending the mission among our parishioners, our family members and friends, that they too may experience true repentance, conversion, and healing through the rays of your divine mercy. We consecrate and entrust all to your divine mercy now and forever, Lord. Please bless all the sacred images of your divine mercy that you have wished to give each family of our twin parishes as that special vessel in our everyday lives to obtain your boundless and infinite divine mercy. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let us pray. Our Father who art in heaven, holy be your name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Holy God, holy mighty God, holy immortal God, have mercy on us and on the whole world. Holy God, holy mighty God, holy immortal God, have mercy on us and on the whole world. Holy God, holy mighty God, holy immortal God, have mercy on us and on the whole world. O blood and water that gushed forth from the heart of Jesus as a fountain of mercy for us, I trust in you. O blood and water which gushed forth from the heart of Jesus as a fountain of mercy for us, I trust in you. O blood and water which gushed forth from the heart of Jesus as a fountain of mercy for us, I trust in you. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Our Lady, Mother of Mercy. St. Faustina. St. John Paul II. Pray for us. Amen. I played that little musical meditation for you because trust in God is the bottom line of this divine mercy revelation of Jesus. The theme of our response to God's divine mercy. Trust is how we obtain it. Trust in Him is how we receive the divine mercy in our lives. Jesus wants to give us all the grace we need right now, and every time we go before Him. He wants us to have a confidence through this image, which I'll explain later, is so providential for these days. He wants to give us all the graces. He doesn't want us to be too late to receive them. Like foolish virgins without oil in their lives, the oil of the Holy Spirit burning in us. So we'll be able to enter into the new era of Christianity and pass over the coming chastisement and judgment. These new revelations of Jesus and His new forms of grace given to us are especially for these last days. The divine mercy revelation entrusted to Faustina to give to the church and to the world is the merciful Jesus opening wide the door of heaven now. His sacred Eucharistic heart open now during the remaining time of His present visitation as we enter into the Ark of Our Lady's Immaculate Heart before the imminent flood of chastisements and serious judgment which is coming upon this world for those who have forsaken their Creator and Savior. I'm going to teach you a little, we're going to pray the St. Michael prayer because usually it's done at the end. But because these are so important, this is the time that Michael stands and defends us, fights for us. I'm going to pray to him. The angels have a great ministry in these days. Just as Jesus came with the angels, He's returning with them. And the angels, your angel brought you here tonight. Your angel brought you here tonight. And so this prayer of St. Michael, which I hope everyone is praying every day, is so important. I At the Feast of St. Michael, I was looking for a song to St. Michael. I couldn't find one. So I asked St. Michael to help me write one. And it came in the form of a military march. You know, church militant. And you know how you do echoing, you know, back and forth and all that stuff is, you know, they march and stuff. So that's how it's going to go. So when I raise my hand, just echo what I'm singing. All right? Very simple. Okay? St. Michael,
St. Michael,
the Archangel,
the Archangel,
defend us,
defend us,
in this day of battle,
in this day of battle,
be our safeguard,
be our safeguard,
against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince,
O Prince,
of the heavenly host,
of the heavenly host,
by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who wander throughout the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.
Amen.
Wow, you did really well. You know, in the kingdom, Jesus once reminded me that everything is arranged. There are no coincidences in the kingdom. There are in the kingdom of the world. There's happen chance, but there's only God incidences. Everything is arranged. And this, as Father Bob said at the very beginning, was arranged. It is not by chance. It was providential. I've been asking the Lord about why this parish? Why is it that you really seem to be calling me here for this? And I wasn't sure until yesterday. The last person I met was Betty, the sacristan. Is she here? Betty, yes. Betty told me that in 1985, this church was consecrated to the Divine Mercy. Did you know that? Yes. These icons, there were two of them. Betty brought them. She got them for a friend who came from Poland. And she offered them to the priest at that time. She said, you want them? He looked at them and said, yes. So one went here, one went to St. Clair's Mission. It's one of the only parishes I know of in the Ottawa Archdiocese, which happens to be your parish, the first in the Ottawa Archdiocese. It makes sense that the Lord would do that with you, because you led it all, you brought the faith into the valley, that this place would be among the first parishes to be consecrated to the Divine Mercy for these days. And Betty told me that there was a real need for renewal. This parish wasn't doing very well. Even I heard that when Father Bob first came, things were still not quite tight as a community. The Holy Spirit hadn't yet fused everybody together. Because that's what happens, you know, in a parish community. The Holy Spirit fuses us together. Let me tell you. The first time I went to Russia, I was invited by a bishop of the Underground Church, the Orthodox Church. I was one of two that were invited from the West. I met him here when he was here on a begging trip in Ottawa. And when I heard he was here, I felt compelled to reach out to him. And he came before he flew back to Russia. And we became great friends. I introduced him to Catherine Doherty and all her work. And we kept on going back. I sponsored him here, introduced him to the Archbishop. I went over there. It was just a beautiful thing that happened. I know it was all Catherine Doherty. Catherine Doherty, the founder of Madonna House, former Russian, of course, all these wonderful things. Anyway, that was where my spiritual community, where I was born, and where I modeled my storefront, Friendship Center, off Catherine's storefront. Anyway, long story short, I went the first time to what's called the Gathering Sobor, of all of those who renounced communism and now were being led back into the faith. And full of the Spirit. It was just an extraordinary day. We had a sports stadium as our meeting place. Most of the churches, you know, were closed, or if they were, they weren't Spirit-filled churches. Anyway, for 3 days, the Holy Spirit fell on us. People came from Belarus, Kazakhstan, Siberia, all of the, Ukraine, the surrounding area, of those who the Holy Spirit was renewing after the renunciation of the occult political power and militant atheistic force of communism. And God was now bringing together both those who were Catholics and Orthodox. Can you imagine? And there were about 3,000. Just like your numbers at Pentecost. And as I said, we were fused together. We celebrated from the early morning until the late night. And when it was time to go to our cars and get some rest, we would regather in the parking lot, grab hold of each other's hands again, start praising and singing to God again. I had never experienced anything like it. I really believe it was a Pentecost. And, I mean, people were, these poor people were saving their food for months so that they could sponsor these people who are also poor and just could put enough money together to travel by train. And they shared what they had among each other. And God was tangibly a sacrament that we were for each other. We knew, though we came from all these points, we all converged in the love of God. It was glorious. It gave me the vision of the church, the way God wanted it, the way He first created it, Pentecost. God wants us to be a community of lovers like Him. He wants us to have His Spirit in us so that we can love others on our own. We can't. We have fallen into our selfish nature, in our union with Him. And so God had to cure that spiritual leprosy. Do you know that sin is a spiritual leprosy? Why all this business of leprosy, Old Testament, New Testament? Because it is the metaphor of the deadly disease that defigures us as the children of God and kills us. Sin is always ends in death, and it is a terrible disease. It's a progressive disease that unless Jesus gives us His Holy Spirit, it progresses until we become overpowered by the demonic. It changes who we are as we go through those 6 stages of idolatry, codependency, addiction, compulsion, obsession, demonization, and possession. Losing our will every so much more until we have no will left and we are possessed. Jesus gives us the Holy Spirit that frees us to give us a free will. That's how we love. We are free in loving. Otherwise, it's all servitude, slavery. God doesn't want that. He created us free. And so we hear today in the reading about Naaman. And, God works very consistently. What He started and began in the Old Testament, He completes. And and finishes, perfects in the New Testament. I was fortunate to go to the mission at St. Maurice, and they had Father Serafin Michalenko come, who was co-postulator for the cause of Faustina, great authority on her, all the backstories. So we heard some of these things. One of the things he said was a miracle that he witnessed and was shared with him. And it went like this. It was an Italian man who went to an audience with JP2. And he brought with him an icon of the Divine Mercy. And he asked Saint John Paul II to bless it, which, of course, the Holy Father did. And, you know, when he bent down to bless it, he said, "Oh, wonderful, you have the Divine Mercy." And of course, he was the greatest promulgator of the Divine Mercy. He blessed the man in the image, and off he went.